Welcome to tutorial number 11 of Introduction to Statistics, Chi-square test of independence. Imagine that we are selecting a random sample from a population with normal behavior. In chi-square test of independence, we will study two categorical variables, variable 1 and variable 2. Our null hypothesis is that variable 1 is independent from variable 2, and our alternative hypothesis, there is some sort of association contingency between variable 1 and variable 2. We will calculate a contingency table in which we will record our two variables. In this case, this is only one example, gender and satisfaction from some product. In the right column, we will have the total number of yes answers, total number of no answers, and in the bottom row, we will have the total number of female and male, and the total number of individual will be 643. Is 643 in this table. Degree of freedom, as we have the rows and columns of our categorical data, degree of freedom is rows minus 1 times column minus 1. In this case, it would be 2. Then, using only marginal totals and the total number of cases, we can calculate, by using proportional reasoning, the expected values. For example, female who will answer yes, the number depends on the total value of yes numbers times the proportion of female, which is 265 divided by 643. And the same for male yes answers. We get the total number multiplied by proportion of male and continue with all other categories of the second variable. Chi-square value is very complicated. It's a long and tedious formula. We will look only at two cells. Imagine that everything is all only these two cells. We are tossing a coin 50 times, and we have in cell 1 observed values of 20, in cell 2 30. Expected values are 25, 25, let's say. And then chi-square is the frequency, the difference of frequency in cell 1 squared divided by expected frequency, which would be 25. The same for the second cell, 30 minus 25 squared divided by 25. Chi-square is a number for each category. Subtract observed and expected frequencies. Square the result, divide the result by expected frequencies, and then add all these categorical terms. This is how it looks in the case that I already show you with six different categories. It's a little long and hard formula, but we will do it with Excel. Before I continue with sampling distribution, I would like to show you how to make a table, a contingency table, and what is contingency table actually. So, to make a contingency table, we will use pivotal table by insert pivotal table. First, I need to tell Excel where is my data, and it is from A1 to B642. I would like the result, which would be a nice table, to be recorded in this cell in here. Now we will have to walk to the end of this spreadsheet, to prepare our table. So gender values will go in the column label, and then of course the other one in go with the rows, and I would like gender to be in these sum values. Now we're going back to the place where our contingency table already is available for us. Very easy, they calculated the frequencies in each cell. However, I would like to make this table a little larger so that you can see how it looks like. We have marginal to tall to the right and to the bottom. I will call this observed variable, observed values, and let's center all this and get a good grid. So this is how the table looks like. It shows how many female vote no for this product, how many male vote no, and what is the grand total. I will use part of this table to calculate the expected values. Now, to calculate the expected values, I will need the p-value, which will give me the proportion of female in this sample. So this is just one random sample with 641 individual, and this p-value is 41. Okay, and then the next p-value for the male is the total number of male divided by the total number, the size of this survey, which is 59. How I will calculate the expected value? The expected value is the frequency times the proportion of female, of course. And this is what I expect if there is no bias. Okay, times if there is no associational dependence on gender of these results. Now I need to have E15 with dollar, and I'm I need to have F15 a dollar sign. Yes. So that I can copy this formula. And these are the observed values. What I will do next is we'll arrange this in a line. Now these are the observed values. I will copy them and we'll put here as values. This is for the male, copy. We'll put them as values. The same for female. Place them as values, and male, control C, place them as values. As you can see, this formula is quite difficult to do otherwise. If I put observed and corresponding observed and expected cells, it's very easy because I can find the difference. This is what I'm looking for, the difference between observed and expected. And then let's see what is the sum of this. Is it something like deviation from the mean? And it should be the sum because it's exactly deviation from our expectations. Is it zero? Yes. It's always zero. This is why we will square them. Each one squared. And this is the value squared so that the sum is not zero. Not only that I will square them, but I also will divide each one of these squared deviations from expected value by the expected value. And these are all categories I will copy to calculate these deviations. To copy them. Yeah, I need to select. Sorry about that. Divided by the expected value. Okay, I have to copy both formulas, not just one. Okay. And the sum of all this is the formula for chi square. Okay. And now I know that the chi square is 123.65. Now, how to test the hypothesis? To test the hypothesis, I have to explain few things about chi-square distribution. Chi-square distribution is almost the same, identical as a normal distribution, but about chi-square on the horizontal axis, which is a standardized test, a standardized score for each sample. So we select samples over and over again and over again and calculate chi-square. With Excel, you see that this is not a problem. Then we do the probability distribution, and the good news is that the probability distribution of all these chi-square values has a mathematical formula. This is how this formula looks like. X is actually chi-square value, or our random variable, degree of freedom divided by 2. There are three places with degree of freedom divided by 2, so I put degree of freedom divided by 2, I substitute with y, and then the formula looks much nicer and easier. Gamma is a gamma function, which Excel will do for you with a little trick. Okay, so this is the function, and I have my y recorded in F6 and x recorded in D14. One trick that we will use is that each one of those four terms I will do separately. X is in D14 to the power of degree of freedom divided by 2 recorded in F6 minus 1. And this is the gamma function. Excel actually doesn't have the gamma function, which is something like factorial, but generalized for the case of whole positive number, of positive numbers. They can be real positive numbers. Gamma of logarithm of gamma, Excel has. If we use the inverse function of logarithm, we can have the gamma function of y. And then I will use the formula, multiplying t1, t2, and dividing by the product of t3 and t4. This is how the chi-square distribution looks like as a probability density function. Let's say that my chi-square that I calculated is somewhere in here. My actually was very far here, but I would like to show you. So if it is in the area of rejection, I will reject the null. If it is in the area in which we fail to reject the null, I will fail to reject the null, and then this is my critical chi-square value, which we can find with Excel. Now, I would show you how to visualize chi-square. Why this is important? This is important because I don't like the plagiarism. So, my x is here to the power, parentheses, y is in this cell, but I would like to have dollar sign, minus 1. Done the first term. The second term, equal exponent, and I have negative 1 times x, which is in this cell, divided by 2, close the parentheses, done. 2 to the power of y equals 2 to the power of y. What can be easier? Now, attention. Y is a constant. To have constant, we need a dollar sign. And finally, this beautiful exponent of gamma, of logarithm of gamma, of this y, of course, I forgot the equal sign. I was so excited that we are at the end of this here. And again, don't forget the dollar sign. Okay. okay, I know what I did wrong, I forgot one parenthesis, they put it for me. And finally, equal, I have a fraction like the scaffolds. And inside the first, I have this function times the second function divided by this function times this little function in here, enter. Now I will copy all these formulas for different, once again, copy for different values. Okay, to here. And this is the graph that I already prepared for you. This is the graph when gamma is equal 2. Not gamma, the degree of freedom 2. I can change the degree of freedom divided by 2 to be 5, for example. It looks much more like normal. I can make it 10. And look, it is half normal. If I continue a little further, it probably will be almost like normal. But I will need this one for my calculations today, and actually it's only for visualization. So let's go back to our test in Excel, and let me remind you that my value was this here. My chi-square value was this value. I will get this value, and I already prepared to answer the question about the test. So, once again, I remember the value, it's 123.65. So this is my test statistics in this case. I need only chi-square test, which is chi-square parentheses. Now, probability I will put 0.95 because Excel doesn't have probability to the left, only probability to the right. Degree of freedom 2. Of course, I forgot. So it is equal chi square and then 0.95 degree of freedom 2. But before that, I have the inverse function which will give me the critical value, and I have to close this. Okay, so 123.65 is much more than critical value 5.99. Reject the null. Thank you. That's all for today.